everybody. I'm Jennifer Catcher, and I teach biology at Pima Community College. I'm here today to show you some of the wet lab activities associated with our DNA barcoding cure. So I want to give a brief recap of why we're doing the wet lab activities. And the whole reason is to help to identify species. So you're likely working with an insect, perhaps a bee, and we are aiming to be able to use DNA from this insect to identify the insect species. So that information, once we identify an insect species, is going to be used by the University of Arizona, by the Arizona Sonora Desert Museum, and others to unlock information about that species with the ultimate hope of protecting and conserving that species. So the wet lab activities that we're going to do are basically divided into three main parts. The first is DNA extraction. So we have to get DNA from the organism. Once we get that DNA from the organism, we're going to do a process called PCR. That'll be our second main step. And PCR is polymerase chain reaction, and it helps to amplify or make lots of copies of a certain section of DNA. And the last step that we'll do is called gel electrophoresis. And gel electrophoresis will allow us to do a quality control check on our PCR reaction. Were we actually able to amplify DNA, and is it enough that we can send it for DNA sequencing? So let's get started. So here I have an insect leg, and I'm adding it to the lysis solution. I have 180 microliters of lysis solution in this microfuge tube, and I'm going to use this small pestle and mechanically break down the leg. So I'm going to grind the tissue a lot. I'm pushing the pestle against the bottom of the microfuge tube here and twisting. And the purpose of this is to break down the exoskeleton so that it can expose the cells to the lysis solution, and the lysis solution with the detergent will help to break apart the lipid bilayer of the cell membrane. So just like dish detergent breaks up grease in dishwater, this detergent should break apart the cell membranes. So the hope is to expose those cells so we can break them down and get the DNA out of them. So I've ground up the insect leg with the pestle, and now I'm ready to add protein AceK. And protein AceK, as you know, anything that ends in ASE is an enzyme. And the protein AceK is an enzyme that breaks down proteins. And that seems kind of weird because we know enzymes are proteins. But protein AceK, what it does specifically is it breaks down the proteins that are part of chromatin. So it helps to free the DNA. And it also breaks down enzymes that are called DNases. And those DNases break down DNA. So our protein AceK helps to protect DNA by preventing it from being broken down from DNases. Now I'm ready to add the protein AceK to our insect tissue. And I wanted to talk about the micropipetter tool that I'm going to use to measure out the small quantity that I need. So this particular micropipetter measures 5 to 50 microliters. 1 microliter is 1/1 millionth of a liter, so it's a small quantity. And the micropipetters are always used with disposable tips. So I've added a tip to the micropipetter. Now, the micropipetter, when you use it, it has two stops on this plunger, which is going to draw the solution up. So I've pushed down to the first stop, and then there's a second stop that I can push to. And when I actually pipette my solution, you'll see how these come into play. So I'm going to bring over my protein AceK and open my microfuge tube with the insect tissue. And you'll notice that I'm wearing gloves. That's really for two purposes. One is to protect myself from any harsh chemicals, but the second is to avoid contaminating the DNA sample with my own DNA. So I'm going to, this is my proteinase K solution, and I'm going to push down on the plunger before I put it into the tube with solution. And now I'm going to lift my thumb to draw up the solution. And I'm going to lift it up slowly. And what I'm looking for is to make sure that I have no air bubbles in the tip, which I am verifying that I don't. And now I'm going to put this into the solution with the insect tissue. So I'm going to push down on the plunger to release the solution. And then I'm going to push down to that second stop, and that will release the very last drop. So now I have my proteinase K and my lysis solution. I'm going to close the tube, mix it gently, and now I'm ready to put it into the hot water bath. So I've got my proteinase K enzyme plus the lysis solution, and I've inverted it several times to mix it. I do see some bubbles in there, so they look soapy. And now I'm going to put the tube in a little float container and place this in a hot water bath. So this particular water bath is set to 55 degrees Celsius, and that happens to be the temperature that is the optimum temperature for enzyme activity of the proteinase K. And we're going to leave that in the water bath overnight. Now that our DNA sample has been sitting overnight in the water bath, we'll go ahead and take it out. And the first step that we're going to do is we're going to add some buffer to protect the DNA, and then we're going to add some ethanol, which will precipitate the DNA. So I'm adding a larger volume of solution this time. So I've got a larger micropipetter. This one is going to measure 200 microliters, and I've got larger tips. So I'm going to add first the 200 microliters of buffer, and so I'm pushing down to that first stop, drawing up the solution, and then I'm going to add it to my microfuge tube, push the last stop so I can get that last drop out, and then I'm going to eject the tip in my tip waste container. So that's what that other button here does, is eject the tip. And you always want to change tips anytime you're using a different solution. So I'm actually not quite ready to do that yet because I need to mix this up. So I'm going to close the tube, just invert it gently a few times to mix the buffer in with the materials that were in there before. And now I'll go ahead and add the ethanol, which will precipitate the DNA. So here we have our tube with the precipitated DNA because we've added ethanol to it. And we're going to use this mini column to help purify the DNA. So inside is a little tiny piece of filter paper. And I'm going to pipette the DNA solution that I have into here, and we're going to spin it in the centrifuge so that it will push the solution through the mini filter. So first thing I'm going to do is pipette the solution that has the precipitated DNA into this mini column, and I'm going to do that, but attempt to avoid getting any of the insect bits that still remain in this tube. So I'm going to try to get all of this solution, but not get the insect bits. Okay, so that is good. Now I'm going to put this mini column into the centrifuge, and I want to show you a few tips about using a centrifuge. So what I've done is placed my tube with the DNA and another tube to balance the centrifuge, placed them both in 180 degrees apart in the centrifuge. And I am making sure to put the hinge of the tube pointing up. That way, when this is under tremendous force, when it's spinning, it won't pull the lid off. Now for preparing to spin the centrifuge, I'm going to put the top on the rotor and click it, and then I will spin this particular sample for 1 minute at 8,000 RPM. Go ahead and start it. So one thing with a centrifuge you want to listen for is quiet. If you ever hear a centrifuge be loud, that probably means that it's unbalanced. So listen to make sure that it's running properly. If you look in this mini column, what you can see is there's some solution at the bottom that's passed through the filter, and the DNA is now in the filter. So the next steps involve washing the DNA to purify it in the filter. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to remove the bottom of this mini column, and I'm going to put a new bottom part on. And now I'm going to add 500 microliters of wash buffer. And this is just to remove impurities from the DNA. So here's my wash buffer, and I'm going to go ahead and add the 500 microliters. And then I'm going to place it back in the centrifuge, and we will spin it again with the hinges pointing up and putting the top on the rotor. We will spin it for 1 minute at 8,000 RPM. So I've removed this tube from the centrifuge following the first wash step. And now I'm going to go ahead and add the second round of wash buffer. So let me go ahead and take off this bottom part of the column first and put on a fresh tube. And then we're going to add the second wash buffer, again, 500 microliters of it. And this time we're going to be a little more aggressive. We're going to wash the, we're going to spin the solution for 3 minutes, and it will remove some of those more stubborn impurities. So we'll eject the tip there, and now I'm going to put it back in the centrifuge, again making sure that the hinge is up and that the top of the rotor is in place. So we'll centrifuge for this time for 3 minutes at 8,000 RPM. So now we have the mini column, and it is purified, and the DNA is still in the column. The next step we're going to do is to elute, or get the DNA out of the column. So I'm going to take off the previous tube, and instead of putting it in one of these collection tubes, I'm going to put it in a regular microfuge tube where I can store my sample. So I'm going to put 60 microliters of this elution buffer. And so I switched to a pipette that could measure 60 microliters. And I'm going to go ahead and use this buffer, but I'll use a sample of it that is in my tube here. And I'll pipette that in, and then I will put it into the centrifuge. And of course, following the guidelines for balancing. Now it's a little odd because I've got this other thing sticking out, but what I'll do when I put it in the centrifuge is I'll put the hinge to the top and then the lid on this second tube to the side. So I had added the 60 microliters of elution buffer, and then I centrifuged, and I went ahead and added another 60 microliters of elution buffer and centrifuged again. So what we have here is our final product, our DNA extract in the solution. So I'm now done with this column. I can get rid of that. And this is my sample to save. So I've made sure that it is labeled, and it is, and then I'm going to make sure to keep it on ice to protect the integrity of the DNA.